Hi everyone, thank you for joining our coffee chat this afternoon. I'm Jennifer Curry. I'm joined by my colleague Donna Glover. Today we're talking about a very topical situation, which is weed and marijuana in the workplace and basically what you need to know. It's, you know, a really changing environment for us in the United States and frankly in, you know, all over the world as far as marijuana goes, and it's really important for employers to understand what their obligations might be and things that they should be thinking about when potentially dealing with an employee who uses marijuana. Just to start out, we have a few housekeeping notes. We have a Q&A box here that we ask you to submit your questions. If we don't get to your questions during the course of the presentation, we will respond to you separately by email. We really would like to get your feedback on these. I know we've done some surveys on our coffee chats in the past, but any information you can give us about how this is going, we'd really like to hear from you. A PDF of the presentation is going to be provided to you in the days after the presentation today to any attendee. And finally, we would like you, and we welcome you, to please join us on social media. Baker Donelson has both Twitter and LinkedIn accounts, so please follow us to get all of the most important and updated news in labor and employment and, frankly, any area of the law that Baker Donelson practices in. So our agenda today, first we're just going to do a really broad overview of the national cannabis laws and how things have changed and kind of where we are today. We're then going to talk about the impact of marijuana on employees and obviously how that might impact your workplace. And then finally, we're going to talk about some drug and alcohol policy considerations, and that includes how to handle ADA issues, FMLA issues, and what kind of policies you should have in place to handle those issues once they arise in your workplace. So just for our broad overview, this is a look back at the map of states that had medicinal cannabis legalized in 2012. You can see it's primarily on the East Coast and some spots along the, primarily along the West Coast and some spots along the East Coast. And in 2012, there were only two states that had recreational cannabis laws that prohibited possession and use of marijuana on a recreational basis, which was Washington, Washington and Colorado. Now, look at what we have here. After last year, after last November, these are the states that have legalized marijuana in some form or another. Obviously, we have some recreational, some medicinal use, some just general possession even, the remainder are still illegal, but this is a major change from where we are or where we were just 6 years ago. So obviously the employers in these states where possession, use, whether medical or recreational, is permitted, really have to think about how they are going to handle employees that use marijuana, potentially bring marijuana on premises, things like that. And even if you're not in one of these states, it's something to not only think about as far as our social awareness of marijuana and the acceptance of its use is changing, but also, you know, if you border on one of these states, you should think about what might happen if an employee happens to cross the border to purchase marijuana and brings it back into your state, and how that might impact you as well. So just some bigger, broader look at the cannabis market in the United States, and this is really interesting to look at here, especially in relationship to the fact that Canada now has nationwide legalized marijuana for recreational use. It is now the largest market in the entire world that has legalized recreational marijuana use. So in the United States, we're looking at a total combined sales of medical and recreational cannabis just in Colorado itself was at $235 million dollars. I mean, that is a huge, huge number, and that's up 30% even from 2006. So 16. So we're looking from one year in 2016 up to 2017, a 30% jump in the amount of sales for medical and recreational cannabis, which is just kind of overwhelming. We have $199 million in total cannabis tax revenue in Colorado. And we're using Colorado, obviously, because that is one state that keeps the most records on medical and recreational marijuana sales and use. And so because they've been doing it for the longest and they keep the best records, it is easiest to see how this market is growing just by looking through what's happening in Colorado. We also have a 25% projected annual growth rate of cannabis sales, and this is just in the United States generally. It was $6.7 billion in 2016. That is up to $20.2 billion, we're expected to go up to $20.2 billion by 2021. And then $50 billion is the projected size of the legal cannabis industry by 2026. So we're talking about less than 10 years from now, we expect that this is going to be a $50 billion nationwide market. So if it's not already in your state, it's very likely to be coming to your state soon. So we have three types of state-level cannabis regulation right now. There's either just decriminalization of it, which means decriminalization of its possession or use. There is medical marijuana and recreational marijuana. And so, for example, in Maryland, what we have is a law that was passed back in April of 2014, signed in by the governor, that decriminalized the possession of small amounts of marijuana, which meant that people were no longer going to be arrested and then charged for simply possessing less than 10 grams of marijuana. What's going on federally? In 1970, we had the Controlled Substances Act, which made marijuana a Schedule I substance along with heroin, LSD, and ecstasy. So it put it in, lumped it in with some pretty potent, high-powered drugs. In 2013, the Department of Justice issued the Cole Memo, which adopted a trust but verify approach and meant that it would not prosecute violations of federal cannabis law in states where the state government has implemented a strong and effective regulatory scheme. So we'll look at, you know, Colorado is an excellent example. Their laws on cannabis have been on the books the longest. And as it goes for any type of violations in Colorado that might be violations of federal law, the DOJ has said that they will not prosecute those kinds of violations as long as Colorado or a state like Colorado has good regulatory schemes for enforcing use, sale, distribution of the drug. Then in 2014, we have the Rohrabacher-Farr Amendment. And what that did is it further extended and codified the DOJ's Cole Memo. And so then we have, most recently, 2018, Attorney General Jeff Sessions rescinded the Cole Memo, which means that he has given free rein to the Department of Justice to prosecute any violations of federal cannabis law, regardless of whether those violations occurred in a state with a strong regulatory scheme or not. So a little bit just briefly about marijuana itself. There are now dozens of strains of marijuana. I mean, they run the gamut. There are over the last 20 years, its potency itself has really increased approximately 3% in the 1980s to up to 15% today. And that's determined by THC and the amount of THC by weight of the actual substance. So THC is the part of the drug that actually causes you to get high. THC can be detected in the bloodstream days or even weeks after ingestion. So depending on how potent the drug might be and how it is ingested, whether it's smoked or eaten, or any other form of ingesting the drug, it can actually stay in a person's system for several weeks on end. Testing, obviously, then, because it can stay in somebody's system for a long period of time after ingestion, testing can cause some potential issues. It can usually indicate, however, and the testing has gotten so good that it can indicate whether ingestion occurred within 4 to 6 hours. So there is a way that this testing works where it can tell how diluted the substance has become in your bloodstream to determine whether you ingested it earlier that day or actually ingested it several weeks earlier. The problem is, though, that none of these tests actually are able to assess or predict impairment. So, and that actually makes sense if you think about even alcohol impairment. You know, one person drinking three drinks may be affected differently than the person next to them who drank three drinks. And so the same can go with marijuana, just because both, either you have two people who are ingesting the same amount of marijuana at a 15% potency rate, does not mean each of those people will be impacted in the same way by the ingestion of that amount of drugs. So like I said here, impairment can be impacted by the strain or the potency, so essentially how pure the marijuana is, the physical characteristics of the user, the environmental surroundings, the frequency of use, and the method of consumption. So with that, I will turn it over to Donna.
Thanks, Jennifer. So I'm going to talk a little bit about impact on the workplace. And as you can see from our slide here, the use of medical marijuana has many, many touch points in the workplace, from state laws that protect employees from discrimination on the basis of medical marijuana use, to the ADA, to safety issues and OSHA. So we're going to try to touch on a few of these today to update you on where we stand. So the implications of marijuana use for employers are many, including the duty to accommodate. When and how that duty arises may depend on where you operate and what laws govern your business and whether or not a state law exists that does protect the employee from discrimination. So let's consider an example from a recently decided federal court case. This was up in Connecticut. The court just issued the decision in September of 2018. And the case is Knopfinger versus SSC Niantic Operating Company, a mouthful. But the court decided that refusing to hire a medical marijuana user because she tested positive on a pre-employment drug test violated Connecticut's marijuana law, medical marijuana law, and the employee won her discrimination case. Now, the way it was played out is the employer, who was a federal contractor, made an offer of employment to the applicant, contingent on her passing a pre-employment drug test, which I'm sure many of you do. The applicant told the company that she was a registered, qualified patient under Connecticut's Palliative Use of Marijuana Act, I'll call that PUMA, and she has used medical marijuana since 2015 to treat PTSD. When the drug test came back positive for marijuana, the company decided not to hire her because, in their opinion, under federal law, her status as a marijuana user was illegal. And so she sued, alleging that the company violated Connecticut's non-discrimination provision under its medical marijuana statute. And here's what the company argued. They said that their refusal to hire her was allowed under the Connecticut law because there was a provision under that law that stated you can discriminate where it's required by federal law or required to obtain federal funding. So they thought that their status as a federal contractor fit in to that exception, but the court disagreed. They also argued that the Federal Drug-Free Workplace Act, which all federal contractors with contracts of $100,000 or more are required to comply with, barred it from hiring her because that law prohibits federal contractors from allowing employees to use illegal drugs. And as we all know, marijuana is illegal under federal law. But the court rejected that argument too, and they noted that the Drug-Free Workplace Act does not require drug testing and it does not. And it does not regulate employees who use illegal drugs outside of work while off duty. The court also rejected the company's argument that hiring this applicant would violate the False Claims Act. The court held that, you know, hiring an employee who uses medical marijuana outside of work while off duty would not defraud the federal government. And finally, the company argued that it didn't violate the Connecticut statute on medical marijuana because it didn't discriminate against the applicant based on her medical status as a marijuana user. They were trying to split hairs and said that, you know, we relied on the positive drug test, not on the fact that she was a medical marijuana user as protected under Connecticut law. And the court said that argument doesn't fly, because accepting that conclusion would render a medical marijuana user's protections under the Connecticut law a nullity, right? So those protections would not exist if you bought that argument. So this particular case illustrates that employers, including those who are federal contractors, cannot automatically rely on federal law or their status as a federal contractor when making employment decisions with regard to applicants or employees who use medical marijuana. You have to be thinking about state law and state anti-discrimination provisions with regard to medical marijuana use. Similarly, while a growing number of jurisdictions do tolerate marijuana use, and particularly medical use, it's become much more difficult for employers to figure out how to reconcile your zero-tolerance drugs policies, which many of us have, with new state laws, you know, permitting marijuana use. And the case we just talked about, you know, the state would have required accommodation for that particular individual, that applicant. So in the states that provide those protections, you would be required to engage in the interactive process. So it's a little confusing because, you know, while a doctor's prescription for marijuana use is still considered an illegal use of drugs, right, under federal laws, including the ADA, that's not going to be the case under all state discrimination statutes. You know, some states like Connecticut have enacted those laws that require you to provide an accommodation that is not going to impose undue hardship on you. Or pose a direct threat to the health and safety of that individual or other individuals in the workplace. So think about interactive process when you're confronted with a medical marijuana user before you make a decision about what to do with them. That is really the key to this, is making sure you're considering the jurisdictions in which you are operating. Also, be sure that your policies are up to date to address these types of issues. For example, Maryland law on use of drugs and alcohol provides that performing tests under the influence of marijuana is prohibited if the performance would constitute negligence or professional malpractice. And it also states that smoking marijuana is prohibited in public places and on private property if a policy prohibits smoking marijuana on that property. So you should be thinking about updating these types of policies, your workplace policies, with regard to medical marijuana as well. Okay, so a lot of times, you know, we have pretty standard, a lot of us have standard drug and alcohol policies. You often see marijuana lumped in together with the prohibitive use of other illegal and illicit drugs. But if marijuana is legal in your state, the legal use of marijuana should be thought about and treated in a similar way as to alcohol consumption in the workplace. Zero tolerance in a policy then is not going to be justifiable with respect to medical marijuana, and in some states with respect to recreational marijuana. And here are a couple examples. Sort of in line with that Connecticut case. There was a 2017 Massachusetts case called Barbudo versus Advantage Sales and Marketing. And the court held, this was a state court, the court held that the employer should have at least engaged in the interactive process to determine whether an employee's use of medical marijuana could have been accommodated. And in this case, the employee had Crohn's disease, and she told her employer about the need to use medicinal marijuana to treat her condition. Now, this was not an applicant. This was an employee. But when she later tested for marijuana positive, the company fired her under its zero tolerance policy, stating that it followed federal law and it had no duty to accommodate. The court disagreed, and it said that the employer was not at risk of violating any law by accommodating the employee, and that an employee should not have to choose between treating their health condition and keeping their job. So that was a Massachusetts case. Similarly, a case in Rhode Island, also decided in 2017, that court held that the state's medical marijuana statute was violated when an employer refused to hire the applicant because of his or her medical marijuana use, and they rejected the employer's argument that the applicant was not a qualified individual because of her medical marijuana use, in that it was illegal under federal law. And the court said, nope, not the case. You need to be able to accommodate or work to accommodate the person unless it creates an undue hardship. So, as Jennifer mentioned earlier, you know, there's been a tremendous shift, here too. So the decisions that we just reviewed, including the Connecticut one, are really a shift from past precedent. When all of this first started happening with respect to medical marijuana, the big states, kind of the leaders of the industries, the medical marijuana industry, California, Oregon, Colorado, the forerunners in that movement, really previously held that employers don't have a duty to accommodate medical marijuana use, even under state law. But that no longer appears to be the prevailing view of the courts, particularly as these newer statutes are drafted that explicitly contemplate the need to accommodate medical marijuana use. So again, it's really important to consider the anti-discrimination laws in the jurisdictions in which you conduct business. Although marijuana still is illegal under federal law, and you may not be required to provide an accommodation under the ADA, you've got to think of those state laws. And at a minimum, when you think about your policies, you should focus them on marijuana use in the workplace as opposed to use while away from work. And also, at a minimum, you should be clear that your company policy will not take any adverse employment action based on a positive test for medicinal marijuana in accordance with applicable law. So again, back to the state law becomes a critical point for those who are operating in those jurisdictions. So what about drug testing? So as you probably know, under the ADA, employers are not permitted to conduct a medical exam, including a drug test, until an employee has been given a conditional offer of employment. But that applies only to legal drug use, right? So, you know, if you're in a state that has legalized medical marijuana, in that case, you would have to make sure you were doing a post-offer medical examination or drug test. But a test for an illegal drug is not considered a medical exam under the ADA. So again, there's that tension between state and federal as to how you would treat medical marijuana in connection with a pre-employment drug test. So the prevailing view in light of the state protections regarding medical marijuana is that you should conduct drug screens post-offer. And think about medical marijuana as you would think about any other prescription drug that you would have to deal with that might come back on a drug screen, and how you would look to accommodate those prescription drugs, right? You wouldn't fail to hire that person. You would be thinking about accommodation. All right. And then finally, on drug testing, you know that you can still conduct drug testing of employees based on reasonable suspicion or randomly, but as we've talked about today, you may have to treat a positive test for legal medical marijuana differently than for other drugs. and, you know, again, back to the state laws and whether or not you have the obligation to figure out an accommodation. And you can also do post-accident testing as well, and you'd have those same decisions at hand depending on what was found on the particular test, the particular drug test. As a reminder, on post-accident testing, though, OSHA does have a newer final rule out that states you can't have a blanket post-accident drug testing policy because, according to OSHA, that would be viewed as retaliatory. So you have to connect the drugs to the accident in some way. There has to be some evidence that potential drug use caused the accident or was a factor in the accident before you can test. You simply can't say, well, if anybody's involved in an accident where the damages are $500 or more, we're testing everybody for drugs. According to OSHA, that type of rule would be prohibited. Also, in connection with criminal background checks, you might have to think about how to deal with applicants or employees who you're doing background checks on who might have old convictions for something that now would be legal. So, for example, Jennifer mentioned Maryland's decriminalization law for up to 10 grams of marijuana. If that was on somebody's background check in the past, you may not want to use that against them. Other types of laws that are providing you with less information about an employee's criminal background are expungement laws, like we have one in Maryland, and it makes it easier for individuals to expunge or shield their records. Maryland has a separate shield law that limits public access to certain conviction records, including possession of controlled dangerous substances for illegal drugs such as marijuana. So an individual can do a one-time petition to shield those particular convictions from public view. So employers over time are going to have less information regarding these types of convictions and or may have to think about them differently in the future. All right, and then substance abuse and the ADA. So how is substance abuse treated under the ADA? Well, use of illegal drugs is not protected, right? And on the federal side, marijuana is illegal. But a history of treatment for illegal drugs is protected. Similarly, someone who is currently in treatment for use of illegal drugs but is not a current user would also find protections under the ADA. I think we all know that under the statute, alcoholism is a protected disability. In fact, it's expressly stated under the statute as a disability. But that doesn't mean that an employee gets to come to work intoxicated, right? So you have to think about the ADA in that way. So you might be doing a reasonable accommodation of a modified work schedule to attend an AA meeting, but you certainly don't have to accommodate someone who comes to work, partially intoxicated or hungover. So on the prescription drug use side, there's no requirement that would cause you to allow a person to use a prescription that would interfere with their job performance or cause safety concerns. And that's where you should be thinking about where medical marijuana fits in, right? It would likely fall there where state law protects an employee from discrimination and provides that an employee has to be accommodated. So under the FMLA, we know that substance abuse could be a serious health condition, and you would go through the process as normal. The U.S. Department of Labor does recommend that all employers have a written drug-free workplace policy that's shared with all employees and clearly outlines expectations regarding drug and alcohol use. Other employers in different industries might have other requirements, like if you're covered by the U.S. Department of Transportation rules for employees in safety-sensitive positions. So you have to take all of these things into consideration depending on your business and how these issues and different and various laws are going to be impacting your business. And then finally, for government contractors, we talked a little bit about the Connecticut case, and the court did not buy the drug-free work Place Act was a defense to violating the Connecticut law. But here, if you are a federal government contractor that does more than $100,000 in business, you are required to have such a policy. And some of the key provisions are there for you. You have to have a policy statement, a drug-free program, make good faith efforts, provide certain notices to employees, and then, you know, impose a penalty on employees who are convicted of workplace drug crimes. So that is a little look. I think Jennifer's going to continue for us with workplace safety, but that's a little bit of a look of some of the touch points in the workplace.
Thanks, Donna. Okay, talking about workplace safety, obviously our biggest concern here is individuals who come to work inebriated in some way that impacts not only their safety, but the safety of others that they are working with. The Occupational Safety and Health Act, which is OSHA, obviously imposes a general duty to provide a safe work environment. As Donna noted, you still have to be careful about how far you go with implementing that. For example, you can't just automatically have a drug testing policy for every accident. It has to be reasonable and connected to the accident that occurred. But again, generally, you have a duty under OSHA to provide a safe work environment. There are also dram shop laws out there that provide employers generally are not responsible for actions of employees who leave work intoxicated. Again, that means that there is an individual who is potentially getting high on your premises and then leaving your place of employment. You have to be careful here, though, because if you have knowledge that, for example, employees are using marijuana in your parking lot after work before they get into their cars, your knowledge could potentially be transposed onto you as far as liability goes, maybe negligence or something along those lines. So you do have to be careful there, although the law generally protects you for things that happen after work or outside of the workplace off hours. And then finally, also we have workers' compensation laws that generally disqualify coverage for any injury caused by an employee's improper drug use or intoxication. But one thing you should also be aware of, just because you might not be on the hook for the employee who is intoxicated or inebriated in some way for their injury, you still will be on the hook for anybody else who might get injured in the workplace on duty as a result of behavior by somebody who comes on site who is intoxicated or inebriated or high, you know, based on marijuana use. So, you know, with all of that, we have it's important for you to identify and implement drug and alcohol policy for your employees that not only complies with the law, but is effective for your workplace and is tailored to your workplace. If applicable, like for example, if you are in a state that allows marijuana, whether recreational or medical, you should have a policy that says use of medical marijuana to treat medical conditions must be treated in a similar manner. And this is how your HR should practice, or anybody who might be dealing with HR issues. It should be treated in a similar manner to other prescription drugs that can cause impairment. So if somebody is prescribed a heavy narcotic for pain, it's generally accepted as something that the employee should be allowed to use without any infraction, unless that employee is coming on site and is incapable of either doing their work or might cause injury or can't operate heavy machinery, things like that. So use of marijuana, even if it's medical marijuana and even if it's allowed or illegal in your state, should be treated no differently than any other prescription drug. So in that case, your policy should make it clear that your employee, if they are using medical marijuana, has a duty to report the use of that marijuana, and they should provide medical information on whatever disability they might have that requires that use. If you have a drug-free workplace policy or you are thinking about implementing one, it really should accomplish two major things. It needs to first send a clear message that use of alcohol or drugs in the actual workplace is prohibited. You shouldn't be talking about anything but the workplace. And it should also encourage employees who have problems with alcohol or other drugs to voluntarily seek help, either outside of work or maybe through an EAP program, which we'll talk about in a bit. These policies it should be a written policy. It should also require supervisor training. Obviously, your supervisors should know what to look for and what to do if they have an employee who's coming in high. It should include employee education and, like I said, employee assistance, like an EAP program. And then also, it should identify what your drug testing policies are. And you should be very careful because a lot of states have very clear, distinct drug testing policies or alcohol testing policies that you must comply with. So, for example, in Maryland, there is a very strict drug testing policy that has several different steps, and it's not necessarily hard to comply with, but they are several steps that you have to comply with. And if you fail to comply with those steps, it's an automatic violation of the law, even if you didn't mean to obviously violate the law. The policy for a drug-free workplace should also exist to protect the health and safety of all your employees, customers, and the public, or maybe patients, anything of that nature. So you should make clear what, you know, almost like a mission statement. You should make clear what it is you are looking to do in implementing the policy. It also can safeguard you, the employer, from any assets from theft or destruction, right? Obviously, people who are using or abusing alcohol or marijuana or other drugs could have the possibility or tend to engage in theft and destruction of property. And so you need to protect that, and a drug-free workplace policy is one way to do that. It also protects trade secrets. It can make sure that you maintain certain quality or integrity, and obviously, therefore, the reputation of your company. And if applicable, it would comply with the Drug-Free Workplace Policy, Workplace Act of 1988, if that is something that applies to you and your business. It should also look to answer the purpose of the policy and program. Again, that should go as part of your almost like mission statement for your policy. Who's going to be covered by the policy? When does the policy apply? What behavior will be prohibited? And in the behavior part, it should be pretty specific as to what you are prohibiting, and it should be all-inclusive. It should also answer whether employees are required to notify supervisors of drug-related convictions. It should look to include whether or not searches will be conducted and by whom and in what scenarios. It should also talk about the consequences for violating the policy. If there is going to be a one strike and you're out, then the policy should be clear about that. And if it's going to allow for individuals to potentially have progressive discipline, it should also make that clear. You also want to keep in mind, though, just because you might have a one strike and you're out or a progressive discipline policy for violation of your drug-free workplace, you still have to keep in mind issues that might come up as it relates to the ADA or any other type of accommodations you might have to provide an individual who is using or abusing drugs and maybe has to or engages in some behavior, maybe inadvertently, that would violate this policy. You should keep in mind that you need to keep your mind open as far as the kinds of laws and issues you need to be thinking about when disciplining employees as it relates to drug and alcohol abuse. Employee assistance programs can be very helpful, not only to employers, but also to employees themselves who are struggling with drug or alcohol abuse. There are programs or resources to help employees identify and resolve personal concerns impacting their job performance. And this can come in a variety of ways. It can be some type of career counseling. It can be a health and wellness promotion. It can be specific drug and alcohol-related services and referrals. such as to, you know, drug and alcohol counselors or, you know, meet programs for meeting others like Alcoholics Anonymous. So those kinds of employee assistance programs can be really helpful, not only in cutting off problems and helping employees to get past those problems, but also helping you as an employer identify ways that you can help your employees and keep your workplace functioning in the right way. Who should consider, as an employer, an EAP program? Really, it really has to be assessed based on a case by case basis. It's not a one size fits all. It's not really necessarily something that will work for every single employer. Obviously, larger employers are going to have greater access and greater ability to pay for or connect with these programs. And frankly, because they have a larger population of employees, they're more likely to run into these issues and need this kind of assistance for their employees. But it's something that I think you need to assess your workforce and what you might need and what your employees might need to determine whether an EAP program might be useful. And frankly, these EAP programs are not just for drug and alcohol abuse. I mean, they can be for depression. They can be for a variety of things that are going on in your workforce that could be helpful to your employees function better, not only in their personal life, but in their professional life. There are some legal concerns, however, that do get attached to these employee assistance programs. First of all, you cannot have a mandatory referral for anybody who you believe might be having a drug or alcohol problem or any other type of problem, frankly, whether you think you have an employee who is depressed or anxious or could use counseling in some other way. You can't have a mandatory referral policy because that is a violation or would likely be a violation of the ADA. The EEOC has said that an employer may not force an employee with a disability to choose between either going to an EAP or participating in that EAP or being disciplined based on misconduct. So, for example, if you suspect that somebody is using drugs, you might not be able to confirm it, or you might not have specifically confirmed it, but you as an employer cannot say you either go to this EAP and you get help for your drug problem or you're going to be suspended. That's not something that the EEOC suggests or recommends, and in fact, if that were to happen and somebody were to file a charge with the EEOC, I suspect the EEOC would take a very keen interest in pursuing that case. You also just have to keep in mind generally, again, this is part of keeping your mind open to the whole vast wealth of laws on these issues. But when you are potentially referring somebody or thinking about referring somebody to an EAP, you also want to just consider whether there's any ERISA issues, whether there's HIPAA issues. And again, the ADA always has to be on mind when doing anything like this as it relates to a health condition. For those issues where unemployment insurance might actually pop up for any type of misbehavior, in these cases, on-the-job drug use or alcohol abuse is going to be misconduct. So an employee, for example, who drove the employer's truck while under the influence of alcohol will be considered to have engaged in gross misconduct. If they are then fired and the employer tries to deny or contest their unemployment insurance claim. So, whatever your local Department of Labor is, it needs to be clear that if they come to you saying, why is this person fired, you need to make clear that they were fired because they were caught having used drugs, they caused an accident because they were high on drugs, something along those lines, because that will be misconduct, and that will be gross misconduct that will be a denial in their unemployment claim. One thing you should be aware of, at least, is that some state labor departments, like Maryland and the District of Columbia, view drug abuse and alcoholism as diseases. So simply having an alcohol problem or having a drug abuse problem would not be misconduct. There has to be some type of behavior that goes along with it, which would include obviously coming to work, you know, on drugs or using drugs on premises. So where those diseases result in irresistible compulsions resulting in absenteeism or performance problems, those issues will not be considered misconduct for unemployment purposes. So like I was saying, if the person actually comes to work and uses drugs or starts drinking on the job, that's misconduct. If they are using drugs or drinking and they get into an accident while at work, that would be misconduct. Or if they injure somebody, that would be misconduct. Or simply just coming to work every day drunk, that would likely be misconduct. But if they are using drugs or alcohol at home and that is causing them problems with showing up to work or being late to work, that is unlikely to be considered gross misconduct, and it would be unlikely that that would then result in a denial of an employment benefit. So with that, I turn it back over to Donna to discuss some practical considerations for employers and how to handle all these the new drug laws.
Thanks, Jennifer. Just like I would say if I were in court, I see, Your Honor, we've run out of time, but if you'll give me a couple more minutes, I'll conclude my argument. So if you guys will stick with me for just a second, we'll run through some of these practical considerations for employers. As Jennifer mentioned several times, you do need to keep an open mind here, and there's lots of laws and issues to consider. Your focus should be on whether the use of medical marijuana impairs their ability to perform the job, just like you would consider any other prescription medication. Think about updating your policies to make sure they're reflecting the new reality that we're in. But also remember that, you know, a prescription for medical marijuana doesn't mean the employee gets to be impaired at work. It doesn't mean they get to compromise his or her own safety or the safety of others. It doesn't mean they get to smoke weed in the workplace. It doesn't entitle them to unexcused absences or late arrivals. But remember state law, right? So if you are required under state law to attempt to find a reasonable accommodation for those who have prescription medical marijuana, you need to do that, or you might find yourself in court like those other employers did. So you really do need to consider all of the avenues in addressing these issues. A couple of key points here. You know, if you go and get a medical marijuana card, it doesn't automatically mean that you have a medical disability and you have, you know, a valid prescription. It's a valid prescription for it. So don't just accept a simple prescription, or don't accept the conclusion of an employee regarding their status as a medical marijuana user. Get the medical documentation to support it. Go through the interactive process and do your due diligence. If an accommodation is needed, you know, make sure you're confirming that the disability exists. What are the requirements? Make sure the employee's job duties are known to the medical provider so they can assess their ability to perform their essential functions of the job in light of the medical marijuana use. Just think about using that interactive process, and particularly if you're in a state that provides those protections. And then finally, Jennifer mentioned this, but, you know, train your supervisors on these issues. Employees are not allowed to be impaired at work, you know, whether that impairment is caused by a legal or illegal substance. So consider training to make sure your supervisors understand how to recognize a drug-related impairment, and then have protocols and procedures in place for acting quickly in cases of observed impairment. And make sure you're doing that consistently and on a non-discriminatory basis. So with that, we're going to wrap up today. I did want to thank you all for your participation in our chats this year. We are going to take off the months of November and December because those are busy holiday months and year-end times for all of us. So you'll see us again in January 2019. We'll be doing the sessions on the third Thursday of every month at 2 p.m. In the meantime, we hope you enjoy the fall and have a terrific holiday season. Take care, everyone.